All right. We're going to get rolling here with our Dream Lab for tonight. And we have, those of you who have been before, we've got a whole new format for how we're going to do things tonight. How many of you have not been to one of the Dream Labs before? Okay, so you won't know there's a new format, but it's okay. So our goal tonight is to interpret more of your dreams. So I'm going to teach just a little bit and talk to you about dreams, but then we're going to jump right into the dreams, hopefully, that you brought with you. For our folks who are joining us via Facebook Live, we were having all sorts of trouble with our webinars, trying to get an interactive process going, and it just didn't work. So this is going to be much smoother. You're going to be able to enjoy the Dream Lab more, but we still don't have that interactive side worked out yet. We'll continue to work on that, but at least we've got a smoother flow for the folks who are joining us online now. Now, in the past, if you have been to our Dream Lab in the past, we did a lot of teaching, exercises, activities, things like that, and then we ended up only getting to two or three dreams, and we ended up with a lot of people here who were hoping to get a dream interpreted that we didn't get to. Now, we've got a big enough crowd tonight. We're still probably going to have people we don't get to if everybody brought a dream, but we're going to get to a lot more of you tonight. And what we're going to do is, when we begin, let me just put it this way. If you have a dream, and there's two things that could happen when you share a dream. Well, three things, really. I could interpret it for you. I could tell you that we're not going to interpret it. And that has two parts to it. That has the part where God didn't give me anything. And you see, dreams are not about a formula that we come up with. Here's a formula, you plug the dream in and you get an answer. So if Holy Spirit doesn't give us an understanding of the dream, we're not going to interpret it because we're not going to do something He's not doing. The second thing that could happen is I could say that, and the real issue is you don't want me to interpret it. That is, it's more of a private issue or something that I would prefer to share with you later because you might not want everybody in the room to hear the interpretation. So feel free, if I say I don't have an interpretation and you the dream you share tonight, feel free to ask me afterwards if I have something or not. I may or may not. And there are also occasions when I just simply say, let's not do that one so that nobody knows why we did it. Because that also preserves your confidentiality if there's some issue, because then you don't know why. Because you see, the first thing that you're going to think after I said that, if I say I'm not going to interpret a dream, is, uh-oh, that was not a good one. Nobody, he didn't want anybody to know. So I'll tell you straight up front, all three of those reasons that I might say no could occur, or none of them. We might interpret every dream you give us tonight. So we'll just see how that goes. Now, what we'll do, and I want you to know this so we have your implied permission on the front side, is if you share a dream tonight, then what our main desire is to teach. Because I want you to learn to understand dreams for yourself, not to have to come to me for an interpretation. So if you share a dream tonight, we'll interpret it, but then when you sit back down, we're going to have a very brief conversation on something in that dream that we can learn from. So we're going to utilize your dreams to teach instead of doing a lot of just teaching straight through. Now, I am going to start tonight with a little bit of a lesson, but before we do that, let's pray. So, Father, we welcome you tonight, and we just invite your presence in this place. We just want to learn and grow together. We want to come to know you more, and we want to hear your voice. So, Father, you've already spoken to those gathered through dreams. Would you now speak to us tonight with interpretations that we might be able to encourage and edify, exhort and comfort, and bring life to those who've gathered? Father, we thank you for your presence. And we give you liberty to do it any way you desire tonight, not just the way we plan. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, we're going to begin tonight in the book of Job. You say, well, that's a strange place to start. You don't hear very many sermons out of the book of Job, right? But I want you to hear something out of the book of Job, the 7th chapter. We're going to begin in the 13th verse. And we're going to talk very briefly about how we respond to dreams and about where dreams come from, okay? Dreams, our source of dreams can be God, they can be our own soul, and they can be the enemy. Now, when a dream comes from our own soul or from the enemy, they can be very difficult for us. In fact, dreams from the enemy often take the form of nightmares, and dreams from our own soul often take the form of selfish desires being played out in our dream. But dreams from God are very valuable to us. If we have a dream from any of those three sources and we seek to interpret it with our own intellect, a formula, our own soul, it will have no life. It won't change anything. But if we have a dream from any of those three sources and we hear the voice of Holy Spirit and our spirit connects to Holy Spirit and we have a spirit-led interpretation, it doesn't matter where the dream comes from, God will bring hope and life into the interpretation. And it will do something to propel you further towards your destiny. So it's really not about where they come from. It's about where do we get the interpretation from when we come to dreams. Now I want you to see what Job has to say about dreams. And then we're going to have a little fun because he doesn't paint a very beautiful picture of them. Okay? So Job chapter 7, verse 13, 14, and 15. When I say my bed will comfort me, my couch will ease my complaint, we already know there's an issue going on here because Job is saying it's been bad, and I think that really if I could just get some sleep, things might improve. He says, but it doesn't work that way because God is still speaking and the enemy is still attacking even in the night season. That's important for us to know. Here's what he finds. Then you, he's just given us the source of his dreams. They come from the Father, not from the enemy and not from his soul. But listen to what he says. Then you scare me with dreams and terrify me with visions. How badly? So that my soul chooses strangling and death rather than my body. That's a pretty bad picture of dreams, isn't it? It doesn't seem like we should use that passage of Scripture to encourage you that dreams could bring hope and life. But you need to understand something. We're reading an English translation of Hebrew words. And so what we see is that Job is saying, when I'm in desperate situations and I think if I could just sleep, if I could just lay down, if I could just get a little bit of rest, you don't abandon me. You still speak to me. And the dreams I have from you, they scare me. And what he says there is, they break me down and confuse me. Why? Because dreams are metaphorical. They're full of symbols. And we have to come to a place of interpreting or understanding the symbols or they remain confusing. And so what Job tells us is when I get a dream, I don't immediately understand it. But you're breaking down my barriers, my own feelings, my own thoughts, my own desires, how I think things ought to be, and you're inserting your plan and your will into my spirit. And if I can just get past the confusion to the understanding, it's going to bring change. He then says, you terrify me with visions. Now, that Hebrew word is interesting because it can literally mean sudden fear. Now, I just want you to know, one of the ways you can tell the difference between a dream and a vision is the impact, the immediate impact it has on you. Dreams are metaphorical. They need interpretation. Visions are more literal, and they're like something's really happening in the moment, and they don't need as much interpretation. The other thing that that term terrify can mean is that you fill me with wonder so that I am terrified at your awesome greatness. And that's the way a vision can impact your life. So what I want you to see is that when God speaks to us in the night season, when we're desperate, when we need something, He can do it in one of two ways. It's not a dream just because you had it at night. And it's not a vision just because your eyes were open and you saw it during the day. The difference between the two are the impact they have on your life and the way you have to come to understanding what was said. So what you're going to see, if you guys can help us just a little bit with scooting in, or some of you guys could get me some more chairs if we need to, that'll help us. We've got a great crowd tonight, but we didn't quite have enough chairs out, it looks like, for our typical way of sitting, right? We don't sit right next to people. We need a little bit of room. So just help me out with that, and I'll be grateful. So what we see with dreams and visions is that they will impact our life, and then how we understand them distinguishes them rather than whether they're at night or in the daytime. A dream is full of imagery that we need to understand, and we're going to talk about that a lot as we go through interpreting some of your dreams tonight. We're going to talk about how do you come to figure out what an image, what a symbol in a dream means. How do we know that? Well, first, it's going to be voice of the Holy Spirit, but there's also some good ways He can take what's already in us and draw it out of us so that we understand it. Then a vision, very literal, can be at night or the daytime, but you don't have to ask very much. It's really clear. Now, there's a problem. The book of Daniel talks about this. He said, when I had visions within dreams at night on my bed while I was sleeping, but I was awake and had dreams and then I was asleep, they just get all mixed up. Daniel talks about this picture where he has visions inside dreams and dreams inside visions. So here's the key. You have to hear Holy Spirit. You're never going to be in a place where you can be dependent on your own intellect or your own perspective. You've got to be willing to listen to what Holy Spirit is saying, even to know whether it needs interpretation or it's literal. Okay? Make sense? Now, one of the things you're going to figure out as we go through dreams tonight is when we talk about symbols, when we talk about the symbols that are most important in a dream, when we begin to pull those symbols out and talk about them after we get an interpretation, you're going to find out that God uses the language we speak. He's not out to confuse you. We just get confused because we don't know how to listen a lot of times. So He's not speaking to you in a language you can't understand, but He's speaking to you in a language you have to learn to understand, just like you would learn a foreign language, French or Spanish or something like that. If we don't put any time into it, we're not going to know that language. And we can become fluent in the language of dreams, or we can just get by with the language of dreams. Dream interpreters, Daniel, Joseph, they were fluent in the language of dreams. Most of us get by. We just understand enough for God to tell us what He wants to say. But He's going to use symbols you're familiar with. If we take, for example, a color in a dream, the color green, you can ask yourself, what would the color dream mean? And you can come up with a dozen possibilities of what it could mean, right? Growth, life, go. Traffic lights green, so we go. Finances, money. We could come up with a number of things. But until Holy Spirit says it's that one, you don't have an answer. So I don't want you to turn your imagination off. I want your spirit to guide your mind, your thoughts, and your imagination as you try and figure out what a symbol means, but you're listening for the still small voice of Holy Spirit to say, that's the one. And if you can hear that about one symbol in a dream, it will unlock a dream for you. Everything else will then begin to make sense coming back to that symbol. You watch for that as we interpret dreams tonight. Okay? So, that's all we're going to do with teaching, but I think it's important we have a little bit of foundation before we jump straight to doing dreams, and then we'll share some more about how this works as we go along. Fair enough? So, have I got somebody with a microphone in the back? I think I do, right? So, if I get somebody who's got a microphone, Melody, if you will just bring that up. Here's what we're going to do. For the benefit of our folks who are watching on Facebook Live, and I know we've got 18 or 20 folks on Facebook Live right now, we're going to ask you, when you bring a dream, I'm going to ask you to come stand between the edge of the lectern and the corner of that step right up here in the front. It's not because I just want to stick you out in the front. It's because I can then coach you on using the microphone so people can hear you online. And also, you'll be in a position where you're in the picture for your dream when we're putting it on the board to talk about it, okay? So who's got a dream? And let me say this, if you'll be so kind to me as to pick your short dreams, not epic dreams, but short dreams. Everybody in here, I would take it, is probably a Christian, right? Anybody who's not a Christian, just being safe, it's okay. I don't have a problem with that. I interpret lots of non-Christian dreams. If you're a Christian, there's something about, because of our source of dreams coming from the Spirit of God, we like to hear from Him. So we get these epic 20-page long recorded movies. You know, street dreams from non-believers are easy. I dreamed I was being slapped in the face with biscuits. Was that the whole dream? Yep, whole dream. I actually got that dream one time. Big guy, linebacker kind of guy with all his football buddies and the cheerleaders with him. And I looked at him like, please. You know, one of the things I teach people is just repeat a dream. If you just need time to process and hear the Holy Spirit, just repeat it back to people so you can both, they know you really listened, and it stalls. So you can hear the Holy Spirit, right? There's nothing to repeat back. Slapped in the face with biscuits. Yep, that was it. I got no idea what biscuits mean. But for some reason, Holy Spirit doesn't always do things the same way. I don't know why I'm telling this. It's important for somebody, I'm sure. So Holy Spirit doesn't always do things the same way. So I can be asking over and over and over again for what does a symbol mean, but sometimes it's a question or just His voice that unlocks the dreams. You know what I heard in my mind? I know it was the Holy Spirit now, but in my mind it was just something to say, not to look stupid. Although I thought the question was pretty stupid. I said, were they canned or homemade? I didn't even get any time then. He just immediately says, homemade. And Holy Spirit said He has an issue with His mother. And I told Him, I said, there's an issue with your mother that you need to deal with because it's a broken relationship that's causing pain for you and her. And He, in front of all His friends, broke down and cried because that's exactly what was going on. I didn't even get the meaning of a symbol. Still don't know the meaning of the symbols. It had to do with His mama made biscuits for Him. And He was being slapped with the biscuits. She was trying to show Him love, and He didn't know how to receive it. And that's what the whole thing. So even though we'll talk about symbols a lot, you got to remember, you're going to listen for Holy Spirit's voice first. It's not even just the symbols. All right, so Kathy, let's go with you. I saw you had a short one, so Melody's got your... Well, it's big print. I saw it was big print, so we'll work on that. Now, here's what I'm going to ask you. Go ahead there. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. And all of you, if you'll take heed to this, don't read your dream. You can look at it. You can remind yourself of it, but don't keep your eyes on the page reading me word for word. Look at it, but express and tell us the dream instead of just reading it, okay? All right, good.
I'm walking around the backside of the place where I worship, which looks like the backside of Avondale School, if any of you know what that looks like. It's high on a rocky hilltop with dense brambles all around, thick undergrowth on this high hill. I see leftover litter and things laying around, food, ice cream, diapers, stuff like that, but no one to help remove this stuff that is still useful. In a corner of the grounds, I see this creature, and he's kind of crawling around slowly like, and he has a mane or an attachment to his back, kind of like a dragon. It's not sticking straight up, but it has embedded jewelry, stones. And in one of these things on his back, there is a black feather. And I saw this creature, and he looked kind of like a dog. He was walking on four, legs. And I was trying to shoo him away, and he wouldn't go.
All right. Josh, if you let Noah know the handheld mic's not picking up well for the folks. So, all right, so let me repeat the dream for you and be sure I've got it. You're walking around in an area on a hillside and what looked like the back of a school, but it looked like Avondale School. There's a lot of trash and things around that you're seeing.
But it is
the place where you worship, okay? And in that, in the midst of all those things, the trash that's around, you see this creature that looks somewhat like a piece on the back of its neck, like a dragon, sort of with embedded jewelry type things. Going down its back. So running down the length of its back.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Now tell me what came after that now? You saw it and then...
Yeah, I was trying to shoo him away.
Okay. You were trying to move him away.
Get.
Okay.
And he wouldn't.
All right. Anything else? We get it all?
That's it.
Okay. So what we're going to do, a lot of times in the past, we've asked lots of questions, but we're going to try and move quickly. So I'm going to get you to hang out for me for just a minute because we may have a question. If you were going to title the dream, what would you call it?
Nightmare on Elm Street.
All right. Was there any color in your dream?
Yes, but it was muted. It was not electric color.
Okay. All right. Muted colors, and what would you call it? If it was a movie, what would you title it?
Oh, Creature on the Hill or something.
Okay. Creature on Hill. All right. So, the first thing we're going to try and do is determine what's the focus of the dream. Where is it at? In this case, it's the dreamer. In this case, it's not the dreamer because she is watching what's going on. She's not actually involved in it. She's just observing what's happening. So, what we're going to see is that as we listen to this, the focus was on the location, so it's on the school or the place of worship. Okay, that's our focus of this dream. Now, what are the most important elements in this dream? They're going to be the trash, the creature, and shooing him away. How do you spell shoo? S-H-O-O? All right, that'll work for us, right? Now, I won't do this much explaining on all the dreams, but we'll go with it here. That's the central theme of the dream and the most important elements of the dream, but there's a couple of other things that are details we want to know about. The embedded jewelry. Or stones. And that is important in this dream. And we probably could get to an interpretation if we just understand these symbols. Now, let's do it this way. What was it? The feather. Yes. All right, let's do this for you. What we want to do is understand this is not a dream from God. Dreams from God are in color, they're in full color, they're in vibrant color. I won't take time right now to explain all of the reason for that, but it has to do with God being the God of light. All color comes out of light. The enemy is a counterfeiter, and therefore he cannot create color in the same way God can. It's always going to be muted or dark in its nature. So the first thing we know is that if the dreamer remembers correctly, because that's important, and it's muted color, then it is a dream that's probably from the enemy or her own soul. If this is a dream from the enemy or her own soul, can it be valuable to us? Absolutely. In fact, this dream is very important. This dream, the interpretation of this dream, is that in your worship, the enemy has come against it with things that look good or appear beautiful in man's eyes, but they're really coming out of a place of discontent, discord, and discomfort. And God is giving you the wisdom to push the enemy back so that you can enter into a true place of worship. So what we understand here is that the enemy is after you in this dream. He's trying to say to you, you can't enter into worship. It's dirty, things aren't clean, and there's stuff around that could be bad for you and dangerous to you, but God wants you to know you have the authority to push it aside. That is true whether you actually accomplished it in the dream or not. Okay? How do we know? It's a school, we're learning. It's a place of learning. But it's also her place of worship. That tells us the heart of what the dream is about. It's her place, her secret place, her place of worship that she goes to, and probably others do too, right? Okay? So, the shooing away, what do you need to interpret there? It's about getting rid of something. Successful or not doesn't matter in this dream because the dream's not from God. It's a warfare type dream where the enemy's saying, I'm going to come against your worship. The fact that you are shooing him away, though, tells us God has taught you authority to deal with things, even in the night season. The trash all around says things aren't clean, things aren't kept well, things aren't being taken care of. This is the enemy's version of her worship, not her own, and may actually relate to a season in your life where you've been struggling. This creature that's there, first thing you think of when it was jewelry or stones embedded in it. Anybody's thoughts? Yes, the ephod or Lucifer or the Pharisees all have, well, ephod has some positive meanings, but the Pharisees and Lucifer, the creature who had sardis and jasmine and the stones embedded in his own ephod, negative, right? It's an attack against the worship. The black feather, throughout history, a black feather, a black coin, a black object has often been a sign of a bad omen in the world's perspective. In other words, this is a sign things aren't going to go well. We could take just this top part of the dream and be stressed out by it, right? But even if we didn't have the shooing away, we know where the dream came from. It came from the enemy to say, you can't engage in the worship you desire to, but God is saying you can. You can not only engage in that worship, but you can clear a place for others to be able to enter in. So out of a dream the enemy intends for evil, God is bringing forth good, saying you have a calling, you have a destiny, and what you see can help others prepare a way to get into a place of worship that you've had to fight for, but you've experienced. All right? Make any sense?
Yes, it does.
All right.
Thank you.
Good. Praise God. Yes, some questions. Where'd my microphone go? Well, my microphone's here, but where'd my microphone holder? Got one over here. A comment or question or raise your hand. So just to draw. Okay, did I have a question before we go on? You can go ahead and get ready. No questions? Okay, I'll take you and then somebody else had a dream today. Was that what it was over here? Okay, I'll take those two next because I saw them, but we'll go with yours first. All right, what you learn out of this dream is a couple of things, what we talked about. Let me just summarize them real quick. We learned color dreams are from God. Muted colors are often from the enemy. And we learned that when dreams come from the enemy, you don't have to accept the message the enemy is saying. You look to what Holy Spirit says because the enemy's revelation or the enemy's information is what he intends to do, and he's just given away his hand. So now you have an advantage. You know how to pray and where to come against so that you can overcome. All right? Okay, got a dream for us.
This is a very tiny clip from a dream I had last night, and I don't remember anything about the dream except for this little piece. And it's like it feels like a school, and I think it's recurring. I think I go there a lot, and I'm usually flying through the halls, and everything's white. I'm usually flying through the halls, but last night, the floor was actually a blue river, and so I'm actually floating down the river, and it's like I'm sitting in a chair. I'm completely, like, relaxed and chilled out. Like I'm sitting in a chair, but I'm not sitting in a chair. I'm just floating down the river. And I'm in cowboy boots and jeans, and it's just a blue river. And it's really calm, but it's definitely moving. And there were a few people that I kind of floated by. They were just watching, and I started trying to paddle a little bit, and I realized I didn't even need to paddle. So I just chilled out and floated down the river.
Okay, good dream. And there was color in the dream, right? Because you talk about the blue river, right? Okay. So in this dream, you're in this place of school. You know in your mind you've been there before in other dreams, usually flying. But in this case, the floor is water. It's a blue river. You're floating in it. You're dressed in jeans and cowboy boots. And you see people as you go along. You're attempting to move or paddle along, But as you begin to do that, you realize you don't even have to do that. The flow or the current is taking you where you need to go. Right?
Yep.
That get it?
Yep.
Okay, what would you call it if you gave it a title?
Floating down the river.
Floating down the river. Now, let's take just a minute here because we talked about in Kathy's dream, and tell me your name again.
Rachel.
Rachel. We talked about in Kathy's dream that she was not the focus of the dream because she's only watching. In Rachel's dream, you could say, well, she's not really doing a lot. She's not the main focus, but she's a participant. She's involved in what's going on. And honestly, the dream still centers around you. Because if you're not floating down that river, nothing else matters. It's a static scene without you present. So in this case, the dream is about Rachel, our dreamer. Now, what are our symbols in this case that are important for us to be able to understand the dream? We've got a couple of things. Again, there's a school. And in this case, a blue river. And I just happen to like the fact she's in cowboy boots. And sometimes the things that capture your attention, you want to pay attention to. Whether you're interpreting a dream or it's your own dream. If it just thinks, oh, I remember that, it was distinct. There's probably a reason. Don't give up on your common sense. Just because God wants you to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit doesn't mean you throw out common sense and quit paying attention to the things that stood out to you, right? So that stood out to me. And with the blue river, she's floating. No need to paddle. So for me, those are the things in the dream that stand out. Let me say this. Most of the time, if you can diagram a dream like this with just the two or three things or four things that stood out to you, they will point you to the most important things you need to understand or hear Holy Spirit on. This is a great dream. It's going to give you the interpretation, and we'll go back and walk through it. This dream says God has had you in a place of training, and He's preparing you, and He's moving in your life prophetically and carrying you to new places in the Spirit, and He's put you in a place where you can flow in the Spirit and move with great revelation without a great deal of effort. It's a season of rest for you so that others can see what God is doing in your life, and you have the ability to put the things of the enemy under your feet and flow in His peace at this time. Make any sense?
Yeah. Totally.
Okay, good. Now, how do we get there? I'll let you sit down. You don't have to stand here for that whole part. How do we get there to that interpretation? Basically, we know the dream's about the dreamer, so we're going to give an interpretation to her. But then we see some things. He's been teaching her, right? It's school again. Now, could the school have a different meaning here? Sure, it could have a different meaning, but unless Holy Spirit says so, let's stick with what we know. What's a school for?
Training.
All right. Then we've got the blue river. Blue, spiritually speaking, blue is a color of revelation. That could have a lot of other meanings. In a negative way, it can be depression. It can have to do with blue skies or blue things that there's peace or things that are coming forth. But it's also a color of revelation. And a river is a flow or it's moving water. So what does water speak of in Scripture? There's two or three things, but this case, it's a real straightforward one. What do you think of? Holy Spirit. So the Spirit is flowing and carrying her along such that she doesn't have to put any effort to it. Okay? Now, where do you get she has authority to put the things of the enemy under her feet? These boots were made for walking. And I'm going to walk all over you, devil. You're under my feet. Do you know God has a sense of humor? He will stick things in our dreams sometimes just because they trigger a memory. And when I heard those boots, I heard that song in my spirit. These boots were made for walking. That's what I'm going to do. And I don't even remember all the song, but I know it ends up with I'm going to walk all over you. Now, I recognize that was not a very godly song. Okay? But if I understand who's going to be walked on, then it's redeemed and it brings forth that message. The Luke 10:19, behold, I give you authority to tread upon, put under your feet, trample, put beneath you on the ground, to stomp out serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Okay? All right, what do we learn from this dream? What we learn is that there are ways that God speaks to us that don't make sense if we're religious. If I'm a religious person, I can't get anything out of a song, a country song about boots walking on people. But if I can hear Holy Spirit, He can remind me of something that wasn't even intended in the way I now see it, that takes me to a scripture that gives me an answer for the dream. Make sense? All right. Who's got another one? Is this okay doing it this way? Does this work? Are you learning some things as we go through these? All right, I promise we'd come to you next, and we'll come back. It could, yes, if we've got one around, that'd be great. Come on up this way, because we're going to keep it pretty stationary, so. The mic, so a stand will help, yes. Okay, oh, I think I turned it on mute. Let me take care of it for you there. All right. Okay, so it's kind of long. Okay, I want you to stand right here so you stay in that picture. You're good, all right? And just move through it quickly. Long dreams, let me just go ahead and give you a little lesson here. Long dreams most of the time can be interpreted with the same three or four key elements that you can a short dream. It's just learning to do it that way. So we may do this dream a little bit different way, and then we'll talk about it. Okay, so go ahead.
All right, this takes place kind of like in a national park.
Okay.
And the focus is me, I do know that. And so I'm in a national park, and a bear comes up to me and tries to, you know, opens its mouth and tries to eat me, but I'm able to escape and go down the spill well of the dam that's there. And I'm running to get away from the bear. And the next thing I know, I'm running up this Vista Mountain. And all of this is in color.
Okay.
So,
by the way, don't just assume your dream is in color, because I said dreams in color come from God, and muted in black and white are from the enemy. You can still get a good dream even if it's black and white or muted, okay? I trust you, but I just want to remind everybody.
Yeah. And then, I've been brought to this Vista place where
All right.
I see nothing but Snow Peak Mountain.
Okay.
And the next thing is almost taken out of science fiction, actually. I start running, and I'm kind of like the Flash, and I break the sound barrier, and I travel, in the past or in the future. I want to say it's in the future, but I don't know that. But, when I stop running, it's at a mountain chalet.
Okay.
And the person gets out of their car, and when they get out of the car, they're panicking, and they say, the devourer's coming, the devourer's coming. So she takes me through this key chalet, and then it's kind of like the Grand Canyon. You know,
okay.
It's just a big drop-off. And so I actually see the devourer, and I jump out, and instead of falling, because it was way down,
mm-hmm.
I start to fly, and I see all these devourers just devouring the land, everything that they come in contact, there's nothing but death,
okay.
And somehow I'm able to fly to another mountain peak, and that's sort of like another part of the world, and I'm at that fist of the mountain.
Okay.
And that's really about it.
Okay, so that wasn't that long. It's okay. Considering some Christians' dreams, that was okay. That wasn't bad, okay? So, all right.
You're going to need to repeat that because the mic isn't working. So if anybody's watching online,
they can't hear anything on this mic at all? Okay, sure. We'll repeat them. So let me repeat. No, it's not working on that mic. So let me repeat the dream back for you. And what we're going to do is, Josh, are you back there?
He's in the audiovisual.
Okay. When he comes back, what we're going to do, we're going to put it down here. And what we're going to do is I'm going to let you, those of you come after this, face me, and the room mics hopefully will pick up and we'll see what works. But they'll be working, if you're online, they'll be working on the sound from the handheld mics. So let me repeat it for you. You're in the dream. It starts off with the bears trying to eat you or to come against you and attack you. You get away. You're at a dam and go down the spillway running away from him.
Slide down the
spillway. And you get away from this bear, and in your next sort of scene, you're seeing this vista, this beautiful view of a mountain, and you're continuing to run, and you end up at a chalet, like a resort-type a home of some kind, I take
like
it, right?
Chalet.
Like a ski chalet, okay?
But I break the sound barrier.
But you break the sound barrier in doing it. So whether you're running into the future or the past, it's a dimensional shift of some kind that puts you there. Somebody comes up in a car. They're very panicked, saying the devourer's coming. When you look out, you see them coming, and you run to this edge of like a Grand Canyon scene and jump. But instead of falling, you fly. And as you're flying, you see all these devourers down, consuming the land and taking things and destroying it, but you fly to another mountaintop in another place and rest or land there.
Yes.
Okay, great. Good dream. Now, let's not do the board on this one. Let's just move pretty quickly and let you see it. In this dream, you can stand down here if you want to and just what in case I need to ask something. But you said there was color in it. Did any particular color stand out? Okay. Grass, flowers, sky,
and the snow.
So basically the natural colors stood out. Now here's something for you to learn. If a color stands out unusually, there's probably an emphasis on it that God is placing. But sometimes color is not important to understanding the dream. I really don't think it is in this dream. It's just there so that you know that God's involved in the dream. It's just natural color. Okay? So this is a dream that says to you, you've been a place where you have been under attack and under assault, and you've almost felt consumed at times. But the Lord has taken you from a place where everything was stopped and backed up, and He's propelled you into a place where you could move out of the plans the enemy had for you and into a place of rest and peace. Even there, you can't get out of the fact that they're all around you. There's been destruction, attack, there's been wilderness, probably your family, probably people around you in work. It's just things all around you. And when you decide to step out in faith, to take the risk that you're not going to be hurt again, but just take the risk you need to take, God has carried you above the circumstances and brought you to a new place of rest. Now, where you're at in that dream is not for me to tell you. God doesn't say to me. I don't know what point in that dream you are. I suspect, just based on discernment, you're at the place in your life where it's time to jump. Okay? And go above your circumstances. But that's for the Lord to reveal to you. I just, on my discerning, that's what I feel. I'm not giving you that as an interpretation to the dream. Does that make sense? Does the dream, does that understanding of the dream make sense for you?
Yeah, it didn't in the beginning, but now that
now it does?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Good. What can we learn from this dream? Thank you. What can we learn from this dream? What we can learn from this dream, there's a couple of things. Did you notice how he talked about the devourer? The devourer is coming, and then all of the devourers that were beneath him as he began to fly. A bear will devour anything if it's hungry enough. So the devourer carried through the scenes of the dreams. It just happened to be that it was a personal attack early on, but it's more broad-based as time changes and progresses. Now, when we talk about running like the flash and being propelled into a place where this beautiful vista and the mountain snows. That also tells us that there is an opportunity to move to a place of purity out of the things that have hindered and harmed in the past and into a new place of purity in your walk. Okay? Because snow is a thing pure and holy and clean. Okay? Risk and faith. John Wimber once said faith is spelled R-I-S-K. And if you're going to jump off a ledge at the Grand Canyon, you're taking a risk. And to fly or float instead of falling says if you're willing to take the risk, God will reward your faith and propel you into new heights in the Spirit so that you're above the circumstances and puts you to a new place of rest. So all of those things, even though it's a little bit longer dream, we really only had three or four elements, three or four symbols that unlock the dream. Make sense? Okay. We're going to try a different mic?
We're trying to get the batteries.
Okay, batteries were the problem, we think. Okay, just bring it back over here and set it up here at this spot. Who else has got a dream? I know we had a whole bunch of hands, and I have no idea how I'm going to go through in picking the order here, but come on, Miss Candy, we'll go there next, because I saw your hand a minute ago next, and we'll go from there. All right? Just turn it here for Miss Candy. Yep.
All righty. I had this. It wasn't a dream. It was more, I would say, a vision. And it was Wednesday morning. I woke up and I didn't get up immediately. I read my Bible for a while. And then I was laying in the bed, and I don't know if this makes any difference or not. I didn't think of it till I was sitting there. In my bedroom, there's a ceiling fan and it's in the center of the room. But anyway, I had my head turned to the right and I shut my eyes and immediately I saw an Indian village. And in the village, there was a lot of color. And the men, they were all dressed the same, and they had on beautiful buckskin outfits. And they were kind of milling around, and then all of a sudden, they got into kind of a circle. And I opened my eyes, and it went away. And so I just turned my head this way, and when I turned my and closed my eyes, and then it was a black and white, and it was like watching a silent movie, like Charlie Chaplin. You know, it was kind of these jerky kind of movements. It was one person, and then there was another person that joined him. And then all of a sudden, I was back at the Indian village, and the color was just mind-blowing. It was just such a vibrant color. And I could tell that the men, as far as I know, they didn't have anything on their heads and they didn't have anything in their hands. And they were dancing around the fire. And I could see the fire in the middle of the circle.
All right. Let me ask you a couple questions. Okay. In this, you saw, you turned your head, as you woke up, you turned your head to the right or to mm-hmm. one side. You saw this full color Indian village, Native American.
Yes.
Okay. Native American village. Just want to be sure. Native American versus country of India Indian. So Native American village, and they're all just doing things and very vibrant in color. It went away. You looked to your left, and you saw this black and white Charlie Chaplin silent film type thing with jerky motions. But that shifted back to the village, and you saw them dancing in the village. Okay? Now, first thing we want to learn here, what did she call this? She said this was more of a... Was it a vision? It's not a vision just because she was awake. Did she literally see a Native American village, or was it symbolic? Symbolic, yes, it was, okay? And we know that partially because of the transition between the silent movie and the Native American village, and partially just from discernment. Only way you really can know, you get it right. So this is still a dream. We need to interpret the symbols. If it were a vision, we would be saying, oh, well, that's it. God's showing you people to pray for. Or something to that effect, okay? But instead, we want to interpret the symbols. So what this says to you is the Lord is taking you back to a place of first, a first love, a new beginning. And the enemy would like to get you stuck in a place of your past, but not the beginning, not your first love. The Lord is not going to allow it, and He's taking you to a place of worship as you worshiped when you first entered the kingdom, when you first had that first love experience. He's taking you through a new beginning and a new place. Now, where does that come from? Does that make any sense to you?
Yes, it does.
Okay? Where does that come from? How do we get there? Okay? We'll go back and forth between the board and diagramming them and just talking about them. How do we get there? Does it make, what do we get from that? Native American, it's why it was important, is the distinction between Native American or Indian. Native American is a people of what? What do they call them now? First Nations. So you're going back to a place of first. He's showing you a first love, First Nation, kingdom experience. Okay? The word for family in Greek is patria. That actually happens to be the name of my ministry as well. It means family, tribe, or nation. And it speaks to the family of God. So the tribe, the kingdom, the nation she sees, First Nations, speaks of going back to the first place when she entered the family of God. Now, the black and white scene. The enemy does not want her to be able to receive and accept what God is doing. He wants to stick her in a place of the past where there was no ability to hear. Silent movie. No ability to hear. But the Lord is saying it won't last. He can't win. You're going back to that first place, your first love, that first thing. And then we know the dancing and the worship in the village. I just happen to know this, and the Lord works this way. Do you know that when there is a chanting of Native Americans in almost all of their languages, there is a similar phraseology. Hey-ya, hey-ya, hey-ya. Okay? Several years ago, a group of Native Americans, First Nations from Canada and the U.S., were in Israel, and they were doing a dance around the Wailing Wall when the elder Hasidic Jews came to them and asked them why they were using words from the ancient spiritual language of the Jews. As they sang, hey-ya, hey-ya, Yahweh, hey-ya. And so the First Nations had a deeper understanding of their spiritual roots than they even understood. And so the Lord is taking you not just a place of first, but a place that's deeper than you've even understood in the past. Very encouraging things. Now, what do we learn out of this? First of all, we learn that sometimes the symbols in a dream are symbols that the dreamer will understand, and sometimes God gives us symbols that the one He sends us to interpret it will understand, because He's just that good. He already knows who you're going to ask about it. So sometimes He can give you just the right symbols that work for the person you're going to talk to about it. I just happen to know some of these things. I've never heard them taught anywhere. I've never seen it somewhere. I happen to have a ministry named Patria, which relates to tribe or nation, and we're talking about First Nations, so I know the Hebrew word. I happen to have known some of the Native Americans who were in that powwow in Israel and Jerusalem and have heard the firsthand account of their story of what they were asked. Nobody else would have necessarily known that. But God will take the dreamer to the right person or give the right understanding to the dreamer so that understanding can come. Right? He's that good. Question? Yeah, how do you go from all this knowledge you've got to me where I don't know much about it, and how do I interpret my own dream? Now, right? Okay? You trust Holy Spirit. The only difference between me and you is I have more experience in formulating the words to express what the interpretation is. Only difference. You can hear the voice of Holy Spirit just as clearly as I do. It may be a little more difficult for you to express what the meaning of those symbols are for yourself or for others, but you can hear just as clearly. Now, remember we talked about something about being fluent or about just being able to get by in the language? How many of you took a foreign language in high school or college? How many of you are fluent in that language? How many of you can remember words and could probably get by in a really easy conversation? Way more, right? How many of you would at least recognize a word here or there from your foreign language experience? That's the different ways we understand dreams. You can catch just enough words to get the gist of things and then have some help to understand it. You can get enough to follow the conversation but not really know what's going on fully, or you can be fluent. You have the ability to become fluent. Dreams and dream interpretation come in two ways, by gift and by training. Daniel was gifted to interpret dreams, yet still, Scripture says God sent an angel to instruct him in the interpretation of dreams. He had both the gift and the training. So you can have either and understand dreams. And what that says to me is you don't have an excuse. You can't just simply say, well, God didn't gift me with that. Because you can pursue Him and draw near to Him and learn to hear His voice sufficiently to at least catch a few of the phrases of your dream language that point you in the right direction. But we have to value those dreams and pursue them. Okay? So we learned some great things from that. It just happens that you need to understand this as well. God is big enough that just because He knew Candy would be here tonight and ask me about that dream and I would have some background understanding that would be able to release it, that He gave her a dream slash vision with symbols that I would get. But guess what? He's big enough to give her symbols that somebody else could have gotten a different way. There's a form of writing the Hebrews, the Jews were fluent in, were really good at, called parallel semantics. And what it meant was they could tell more than one story with the same set of words. Okay? If you look in Isaiah, you'll see stories about the king of Tyre and the king of Sidon, but you'll also see that they're telling the story of Lucifer's fall. One set of scriptures that tells two stories. That's true in much Hebrew writing. And what you need to understand is God is good enough to give you a dream that you can understand in one fashion, but somebody else can get in a different way, and another person can see it in another way. And guess what? He's also big enough to give you a dream that has unfolding layers of meaning over time that you don't have to get all at one time. Right? Okay. Let's see, who's next? I saw your hand. I know, look, I got them going everywhere now. So come right here to the mic for me.
Okay, I was in a Chinese restaurant. I felt unwanted there. And I was with two friends, and I was waiting on the third. And I remember seeing it was chicken. It was like chicken soup and beef soup. But they were in teacups, like little sipping cups. And they had scrolls in them. And you would eat them. But I can only guess that only scrolls was like what comes in those cookies.
Like a fortune cookie,
like a fortune cookie
paper.
Right.
Okay.
Right. But and that was it. The third person came up. But another thing was it was like a jewelry store. But I felt really unwanted. Like it was an original Chinese restaurant.
Okay.
The China people didn't want us there.
Okay. So, in your dream, you're in a Chinese restaurant, you feel unwanted, you're with two people, but you're waiting on a third.
Right.
You're looking at the food, which is some soups, I think you said it was?
Beef and chicken.
Beef and chicken soup in a little teacups, but they also have a little scroll in them that you're eating the scroll and partaking of the scroll.
Right.
And the third person eventually does come up,
right.
but you still feel uncomfortable that you're not wanted. There's the jewelry store kind of aspect, mm-hmm. and the restaurant the aspect.
That, like the open casings, like where you would view jewelry at.
Okay.
And that's what it was.
Okay.
The
all
right. Tables in the middle.
Tables in the middle. So you're in this jewelry store slash restaurant, uh-huh. but you feel unwelcome, and it was almost like it was an original Chinese restaurant.
Right, like in Chinatown.
Like in Chinatown or something. Okay, great. Let's look at this. This dream, one of the things we, 90% of the time a dream is about a dreamer, so I'm not going to always explain why the dream is about one thing or the other. This dream is about the dreamer. All right. And what are our important elements we want to learn from? One, he's with two people waiting on three. Okay? In the restaurant, what is being eaten is a soup with scrolls. And it also has a restaurant, jewelry store element. All right? And a feeling unwanted. All right? Let me just say this real quick in teaching. Feelings, emotions can be just as important as the symbols you see in a dream. And sometimes those emotions are literal. The emotion is what it is. And sometimes they represent something else, not your actual emotion. But emotions can be just as important. What we find here is that, what is when he said that there was soup, but there were scrolls, and you were eating the scrolls, what do you think of? The word, Ezekiel, take the scroll, it's bitter, but it's sweet as it's received. When we talk about a restaurant, the Chinese element of this is not as important as it is. It was an authentic, a traditional restaurant. Restaurant is a place we go to eat or to consume food. But it also had a jewelry store element, which is a place where we find things of value. Okay? But he feels unwanted in this traditional atmosphere. Though it should be providing food and things of value, there's a feeling that he doesn't fit in. Okay? And then finally, he's with two, waiting on the third. Any thoughts? The Trinity, right? Something about that just stirs up. So here's the interpretation of your dream. Tell me your name again. I'm sorry.
Matthew.
The Lord is saying to you that you've been in a place where the traditional church has rejected you in the past. And you have understood a relationship with the Father and the Son, but you're about to come into a new place of understanding of your relationship with Holy Spirit that's going to remove the feelings of neglect and unwanted and unwelcomeness that the church has meant to you in the past and bring you to a place where you can truly receive the word he has for you. And though it's been bitter in the past, there's a sweetness coming that's going to take you into a place you can access the things of value he's always had there for you.
Amen.
Does that make sense?
It does so much.
All right. Amen. Okay. Cool. There's not many restaurants you could associate with real, traditional, authentic, old style than to say a Chinese restaurant in a Chinatown setting. If you've ever been to one, you know what I mean. They just carry tradition forward forever. And so it's just a really neat picture. The Chinese element was there as an added piece to tell us what it was about. It wasn't about it being Chinese food. Make sense? But it tells us something that helps us understand that traditional atmosphere that we're in. Now, here's what we're going to do. We're going to take about a 3 to 5 minute break. I'm going to let those of you who might need to get up, move to the restroom, whatnot, take that. We're going to check our microphones and things like that here. We're going to take just a minute with that. And I'm going to, when we come back, I've got a couple of little things I want to share with you. But I'm going to let you get up, stretch, those sorts of things. We said we would do 7 to 8:30 in one of our announcements. And another one, we said we'd do 7 to 9. So if you're wondering which is it, if you need to go at 8:30, that's fine. We'll probably go a little bit longer and meet in the middle there somewhere so we can get 4 or 5 more dreams. But just stand up, stretch. If you need to run the restroom, we're only going to take about 2 or 3 minutes here for me to take care of a couple of quick things.
Check 1, 2, check. All right, we're going to begin to make your way back in. I got a couple of things to announce. I told you just 2 or 3 minutes, so I just needed to move a little bit and check on some microphone issues. For our folks on Facebook, we're going to really encourage you, if you're here live, put your mouth almost like right on the microphone. Speak clearly and loudly into the microphone. It will help our folks on Facebook Live who are learning as we go as well. If you're watching on Facebook Live, that's one of the reasons I try and repeat the dream for you so that you do know what's going on if you didn't hear it. But for folks here, just step right up to that microphone, speak as clearly as you can. Now, Noah, if you can put that graphic up on social media, let me just let you know, if you want to know when we're doing things like this, our next Dream Lab is March 16th. It's a Thursday night. You might say, why on a Thursday night? Well, why not? That's right, it works. The reason will be March 16th is whenever I'm on WDJC interpreting dreams in the morning on the show with Roxanne and Chris, we always do a dream lab that evening so that the people who didn't get to a dream on the show have one more opportunity to come and get a dream done. So it will be 7 o'clock on March 16th. If you want to know about things and you're not here for this announcement, know if you can put that graphic up for folks on Facebook. Joshua, if you'll tell him. We have 3 channels of social media right now. We have the Facebook page. You can go to Facebook and search Michael B. French. I use B because there happens to be an English author who has a lifestyle that I'm not real fond of whose name's Michael French, and so I use my middle initial to distinguish. And also then you can find me on Facebook because I'm the only Michael B. French
I'm one of two or three, I think, so it makes it easy to find me as opposed to a lot of Michael Frenches. So you can find me on Facebook. I have a private personal page on Facebook. That you're welcome to send me a friend request. I'm more than glad for you to. However, that is not the place to learn about things that are going on. The place you're going to learn about things we're doing is on the Michael B. French author page. We post our calendar, let you know about events, put up Facebook invitations from there, and it's where we broadcast from Facebook Live for things like this. We also have a Twitter account. A lot of things that go up on Twitter are just little short snippets, things the Lord speaks to me, or reminders about things. I am at RevMike88, RevMike88. That's where I am on Twitter. And then beginning this morning, for those of you who might be watching or here who already follow me on Twitter, I owe you my apologies because we opened our YouTube page this morning, and I posted about six videos, and it tweeted every one of them like three times to people. So if you got like 16 tweets from me this morning, I apologize. We won't do that again, or we'll do our best not to. So on YouTube, if the Lord gives me a prophetic word, we'll actually post this Dream Lab back to YouTube in a day or two. YouTube will have video things that we do, prophetic words, teaching, announcements at times, just different things like that. And if you'll go out and use my website, michaelbfrench.com, there is a YouTube icon at the top of that page. You can click that and get to the YouTube page, because right now, since we just opened it, we can't have a personalized YouTube account. So it's a bunch of letters and numbers and stuff that distinguish where we are that's too hard to explain. So just go to the web page to get to the YouTube account. And when we get 100 subscribers there, they'll let us put a shortened URL name in, so you'll be able to get to that easier. So that's ways you can find out about things we have going on. Now, the next thing I want to do in the end here in a little bit, we're going to receive an offering here tonight. Most of you know I'm here at Kingsway. I'm not technically on staff at Kingsway. I was pastor here for 17 years when we turned things over to Jason and the Kingsway, and I have I'm independent itinerant ministry. I work with leaders all around the world, and we travel and teach on dreams, hearing God, and also just supporting leaders. We have about 100 ministries around the world we pour into, and that ministry is what Lisa and I do, and we are supported through donations and offerings. So we're going to receive an offering tonight. When we do that in a little while, if you want to make a check, it's to Patria Ministries. We also have our Patria, P-A-T-R-I-A. We also have offering envelopes back there in the back for one-time gifts, or if you want to partner with us in a monthly way to help support us for all we do, you can do that through the offering envelopes, and either a credit card or PayPal or something like that. You can also go to our Patria website. It's on the envelopes. The URL for it is on the envelopes, and do it through PayPal and things like that if you'd like to do it. So those are available for you. You guys watching on Facebook Live should have a graphic that has the online method of contributing out there for us. I used to not be real great at taking offerings. I'm still not that great, but I did learn this, and that is Paul talks about people who partnered with him to advance the kingdom. And when he says to them, what he says to them is that because you partnered with me so that I could do what God had given me to do, God is going to meet your needs. He didn't just say he'll do whatever. He said because of the partnership, and when we have find a place of good ground and good soil that we can sow into, then we reap a benefit back from that as well. And so I do believe the things we do are good soil. Obviously, I do because I do them. But if you see them as good soil, if you see it as a place to sow, then I encourage you to sow into that, help us accomplish our ministry, but also reap a part of that harvest with us as well. I will say this to you, it's very important to me. Do not, with capital D-O-N-O-T, do not take from your tithes or your church offerings, your local church offerings, to give to our ministry. We're adamantly opposed to that. I actually would rather you not give at all than to take away from your local body where you're fed on a regular basis to give into our ministry. If you can't give an offering above your tithes and offerings to your local ministry, it's okay. Pray for us. That works just as good, okay? So that's very important to us. We were pastors for 17 years, and we truly believe in the local church. So I just want to emphasize that to you. With that, we also have a product table, my books, Elisha Way on Spiritual Fathering, Remedy on Spiritual Warfare and Deliverance, and Fresh Bread, a really new approach to what God is saying through the Lord's Prayer, are back there on the table. They're $10. You're welcome to take one. Just drop the $10 in the basket back there. And I'm just this way. If you really need one of those books and you don't have $10, then just come see me and take one. That's just who I am. And there's also some color cards on the table back there from Streams Ministries that they're color wheel cards. I don't think they're the most popular Dream aid that we have, but it's the only ones I have tonight. So, yes. Those are $5, and you're welcome to just drop it in there. We can also take a credit card tonight, I think, but I may have to show them how to do it at the end.
Okay, so books are 12,
2 for 10. 12, 2 for 10. Okay, thank you.
12 for 1.
I don't know what I'm doing. Right. 12 for 1, 2 for 10. That's what. 2 for 20. 12 for 1, 2 for 20. Hey, buy two. They're cheaper than buying one. So there we go. Right, thank you. You are correct. That is what they are. Okay, let's see. What else did I need to tell you before we start back here? Let's see. I think that covers everything. We'll stop here at the end, pray for you, and receive an offering. We don't have enough team members tonight to do very much in the way of dreams at the end. We'll try and do a few, but what we can when we close out the Facebook Live, but we don't have a lot of our team members here. If you've taken our Dreams classes and would like to give things a shot, we will give you an opportunity to practice tonight. You guys who are getting Dreams interpreted, just to know, you might have some folks who are learning, and that's okay. You can't grow if you don't try, right? Okay, so I've got a dream right here. I promise that we would go straight to you because you're aggressive and you've got a dream you want to get done. Right? Okay, good. Okay, tell me your name.
Kathy.
Kathy. Okay. Kathy. All right. Right into the mic for me.
Okay. Is that good enough?
It should be.
Okay. I had this dream. I was floating up above a situation and looking down, and there was this big, huge fish that appeared to be jumping out of the water. It was very healthy, very... And I was questioning, why would that fish be jumping out of the water? And then soon after, I saw this big snake come and devour this big fish. And then I saw other fish jumping out of the water and other snakes. And then there were a lot of little fish that were just flapping like they were getting ready to die, you know, just flapping up and down. And then I was carrying something, holding on to something as I'm doing what in the air. And it appears that whatever I was holding on to, it turned and looked at me, and it was like a snake, and it smiled, and I just threw it away from me, and I actually woke up throwing my pillow away from me.
Okay. Color in the dream?
Not other than the fact that the fish were very healthy.
Okay.
And then I said, oh, I need to warn my brother, because I thought he was supposed to be at this event or coming to an event. I need to warn him not to come. Into the situation. And so I just looked out and surveyed the land, didn't see my brother, and I said, oh, he didn't come, so I don't have to worry about him.
Okay. So you see the fish, some are jumping out of the water, different things, but there's snakes going after these fish. Some are flopping.
Yeah, not going after them, they're just devouring
them.
Opening up and just taking a whole big snake.
Okay, so they're not just attempting to get them, they're devouring them.
No, they're devouring.
Okay, and then you realize you're
holding something
that when you look at it, it's a snake that sort of turns and smiles at you. You have to sling it away.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Now, we're not going to use the whiteboard as much the second half because we're going to try and move quicker through some of the dreams. That's a great dream. It's a calling dream. If you'll notice, you're a participant in this dream. You're not necessarily the main focus of the dream. And the dream is not really about you as much as it is about your gift and your call. Some people would say fish relate to evangelism. That is, we catch the fish and you're seeing them devoured by the enemy. The Lord is giving you insight to see how the enemy is consuming the unsaved around you so that you would have understanding to pray and call forth their freedom, to bring warning to them and those who were called to them. He is also revealing to you the things in your life, the lies that the enemy has had attached to you to keep you from fulfilling your call. He's revealing it to you, and it may even be things that you've been very comfortable with in the past that you didn't even know you were carrying, or that even in some ways seemed pleasant, but he's revealing to you how to release those things or to reject those things so that you can focus on your purpose and your calling. So he's not only showing you the lies that are consuming others, he's revealing the lies that the enemy has said about you that have kept you from fulfilling your purpose. So while your call is not evangelistic per se, it has great impact on evangelism in the kingdom. Your call to warn and to cry out to the Lord and to recognize what is causing the harm to others will make evangelism and those who have a gift of evangelism much easier to walk in.
Thank you.
It makes sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good.
You jump ahead.
All right. Good. No, it's okay. Hey, that's okay. Look, fish do represent evangelism. They do represent the unsaved, but they don't have to always represent the traditional way we see it. A lot of times you see people with dreams with fish, and people will immediately jump to the idea of evangelism because it's about, we talk about Jesus sending us out as fishers of men. So we think about fish in that regard. But if you wait on Holy Spirit, you'll get understanding of what he's saying in a particular dream. Snakes often represent lies, deception. One simple reason is kind of a pun. They're one big tail. Okay? So it's words, lies, deception, criticism, things of that nature. So these snakes devouring the fish, you're not actually catching the fish. It's not about evangelism. But you're identifying what's costing those fish their life before they can be caught. You're seeing the lies. So God's giving you that discernment and insight. And usually if you can't find a mechanism of what do I do with it, you pray. So it's a call to prayer and a gifting in that arena. All right? What else we got? Who is it? Okay, let's see. Boy, just jump right there. All right, I'm going to go right here. Then I saw right back there. We'll do those two next. All right. Get it up there? Yeah.
I think that's it. This takes place in a plane, and there's four or five other people in there. We're all in different suits, and it's a parachuting plane that you jump out of. My instructor comes up behind me, and he puts an earpiece in my ear, and he goes, "Don't worry, I'll be with you the whole way down." So the minute we jump out of the plane, about a minute afterwards, he releases from me. At this point, I'm screaming at the top of my lungs, "What are you doing to me? What are you doing?" And he goes, "Relax. Just put your arms out." So I put my arms and my legs out, and I was in the yellow suit, and it was a flying suit, one of those suits you fly in. Yeah. And now I'm enjoying it going down, and as we're getting into the clouds, I was getting nervous and scared, and all of a sudden, I'm engulfed with all these white clouds, and my instructor speaks into my ear, and he goes, "Put your stick out." I don't even know where the stick come from, but as I did, I can't see, but I feel the wall all around me. He goes, "You're in the volcano. You need to get out." And I'm like, "How do I get out?" He goes, "Pull your parachute." So as I pull my parachute, it immediately yanks me back up out, and we're floating over the ocean. He goes, "The island is our destination." He goes, "But about 20 feet above the water, you need to release." And I'm like, "That water's not deep enough." He goes, "The water's crystal clear." He goes, "It's very deep." I said, "No, it's not." He goes, "It is. Release." So I released, fell into the water, and there was about four or five of us swimming. I mean, there were strong swimmers towards the island, swimming strong and hard. And all of a sudden, I see them swimming strong and hard, and I'm up to my waist in the water where I can run, and they're still swimming. Next thing I know, I'm on the island in a white shirt and a pair of blue jeans, and the villagers are saying, "We need to gather firewood for lunch." And So I go with one of the little village kids, and the village leader said, listen, you need to be careful. There's a very deadly snake on this island called the Black Mamba. It will kill you. I don't even know if that's a real snake. But he goes, it will kill you. So as I come around a little hut with one of the little village kids, there was a green garden hose there, and then I see this long black snake coming around. I grab the kid and I pull him behind me, and there was an old paint scraper there about this long. That's all I could find to kill it with, but it wasn't moving fast, and I was scared. I'm like, it could attack me. So I reached out, and I had to hit it twice, but I was able to kill it. And one of the villagers came around, wrapped it around his arm. He was running around. We're going to eat it. We're going to eat it. And then I woke up.
Just like a dream, isn't it? Yeah. Good. Now, let me show you something. That was a pretty long dream. Lots of detail. That dream's about your calling and your purpose. That dream says you've had the Lord with you all the way through. And where you've had to step out in faith, He's always been there. His voice has always been there for you with direction and instruction. The things that have caused you fear in the past have often turned to hope. You've been through trial by fire, but He's brought you out. He's carrying you into deeper places in the Spirit, giving you authority over those things that would have killed you in the past and bringing life to you even out of what the enemy intended to destroy you with. Great dream. Dream about destiny and purpose. It's long, it's detailed, but there's just key pieces in it that tell us this dream is about being safe in His arms and how He's grown you through the difficulty and taught you to trust Him so that you could accomplish your purpose. You know that you can do it because His voice has been there for you all along. Make sense?
Yes, sir.
Amen. It's good. Where do we get that some of that from? It's a good dream. With a long dream, but here's a few things. Parachute, that's a safety net, but you can't use it. You've got to fly. Okay? The flying suit's yellow. Yellow is a color that has two distinct, different direction kind of meanings. It's a color of fear, but it's also a color of hope. So what you did fear, when you begin to get comfortable in it, brings hope. Wait a minute, you're in a volcano. The baptism of fire, the testing of fire, we have to go through it. We all will walk through those seasons, but He's always going to pull us out before we get truly consumed. You have to trust Him, let go, release your plan, your view, your perspective to fall into the things of the Spirit. And when you come out of that, you carry authority to both recognize what the enemy is doing and deal with it so that it now can bring life to other people. What the enemy intended to kill them is now going to be food for them because it's going to bring strength to them. So there's people around you who your life impacts and it changes their destiny just by doing what God's given you to do. You may not think of it as being much, and you may not think you have really all the tools that you would choose, but you have what you need. A paint scraper doesn't have to be just a paint scraper. It can still be a weapon in the right hands. Amen? Good. All right, I said I was going back there for a dream, but I got a question. How do you know a dream's about call? A lot of times a dream is about calling when you see the hand of the Lord moving over and over in it. Voices in His ear. Don't pull the ripcord. You're now in the volcano. The journey that you're on in that dream speaks of your purpose or your calling and what you're flowing in. Other times it's just discernment. You just know, you just see. We won't take time to do it tonight, but I sort of work off about 20 categories of dreams, types of dreams that we could work with. There are probably more. It's just 20 is a number I was taught, and it's easy for me to drop dreams into various categories. Calling, intercession, prophetic, spiritual warfare, fear dreams, dreams of healing. There's just all these different things. And many times for me, I just sort of hear the voice of the Holy Spirit as a dream starts, say that's the group it falls into, or that's the category it falls into. I don't think you have to know those categories. They're just a shortcut way I hear Holy Spirit. So you learn certain things that are training, and then Holy Spirit will say, pay attention to that. Okay? I tell people I have like a filing cabinet of dream symbols, and when I hear a dream that talks about, say, a dog, I go to my filing cabinet that has animals in it. I pull out the drawer for dogs. I flip through till I find the breed. I pull that out. And this is old school, I know. It would be all digital files now. But I pull that file folder out. I open it up. And I look at all the possible things that symbol could mean. And Holy Spirit says, not that one, not that one, not that one, not that one, that one. Or I might go through all of them and he says, nope, I want to show you something new. Okay, now I don't literally do that, but that's the process I kind of can relate to of what I go through in my mind with doing dreams. So, all right, we got yours back there. Come on.
Okay, so the dream starts with me talking to my dad. We're like in a park setting, and we were talking to this man.
And step up real close.
He was telling us about a bird or different species of birds, and he said that there was one in particular. It was like a giant bird that had, it was all white except for it had turquoise crown and feet. And we decided to walk. We were walking past a church, and I guess church had let out. The congregation was in the front. There was this giant statue, and in the statue there was a bird's nest, and there were chicks in there, and there was this giant bird there, and it was ugly, and it wasn't graceful, but I knew that it could fly. And then all of a sudden, that white bird that the man was talking about with the turquoise crown just swoops into the crowd, and the crowd starts feeding it and petting it, and then it turned around and it killed a lady. And it's her little girl, and the lady was pregnant. And I was so upset, and I went to help the lady, and I was beating at the bird, but it wasn't paying attention to me. It was just, you know, devouring the people. And all the people that were around me, they weren't doing anything. It was as if they didn't see what I was seeing. And then I remember we went into the church doors, and then all of a sudden we were in a tunnel. When we came out of the tunnel, it looked like a clinic, and then we went through some corridors, and then it looked like a restaurant. We went through to the back, and then it was another courtyard, and I saw this giant evergreen tree, and the little girl that just was devoured, she was climbing up the evergreen tree, and then I woke up.
Okay, good. Now, let me share this with you. When, just so, because sometimes the different ways I can teach in different ways, and this might be a good way to just sort of show you a process I walk through when I'm hearing a dream. When I'm listening to a dream and she begins to talk and she says there was this giant bird and it was white with a turquoise crown and feet, I immediately knew that was negative. I can't tell you why I knew that. I knew that it was demonic. It was a religious spirit. I knew that in my spirit. So I'm waiting because that bird could, white could be pure. White, I mean, it could be, birds could be angels. All kinds of good things that can come from birds. But I know what I heard, so I just had to wait as you walked through that dream till it got to the point it was clear that that was a negative symbol. And now the Lord's confirmed for me something He told me before I hear the rest of the dream, and I have a confidence now that I know what the dream means. That's one of the ways you can walk through a dream. You're listening, you're listening. Don't dismiss that thought you have of that could be. Just let it flow with the rest of a dream. And then as the Lord confirms it, you can have a confidence what you're walking in. It's really a good dream. You said you were with your father and another man, mm-hmm. Or was the man your father?
Yeah, I was with my father, and it was another man that started talking about the different species of birds. But he specified that white bird with the crown, the turquoise crown.
And did the other man, was it somebody you could identify, you could describe them? Was it, how would you?
No, it was just somebody that started talking to us. Me and my father were together, mm-hmm. And he just suddenly, I guess he was just talking to us suddenly.
What? Good. So names in dreams, including names of positions, can have meaning. So if you have the name of the person you were with, it was his position was father, right? Mm-hmm. So that means that that person probably represents the father. Mm-hmm. You're with the Lord. You're walking with the Lord. And he sent people around you to impart to you wisdom and understanding so you would have discernment where others don't perceive the demonic attacks they're under, and particularly where the religious spirit is draining them of their life. You're able to see it and come to their aid where others don't even know what's going on, because he's put people around you to pour wisdom into you. He's walked with you. The Lord is your heavenly Father has walked with you, and he's put people around you to pour into you so that you would discern and be able to come to the aid. Now, you felt at times that you couldn't do anything to change the circumstances around you. But God is telling you it's not about the results you see with your natural eye, because when you move into the spiritual realm, walk through that place of healing, enter into that place of receiving provision from Him, and step into the courtyards of heaven, life has been brought to even those who you thought were lost because of what you've been able to pour out and sow into them.
Wow.
Okay? So it's a powerful dream about purpose. But it's really about warfare. God has equipped you and gifted you to engage in that warfare, and he's trained you and put people around you. You may not fully understand it yet, but trust that what you give away and what you do does make a difference in the kingdom. Amen. Make sense?
Yes, it does.
All right, good. Now, real quick, let's just think about that. What is going on here? Birds are things, are little creatures that fly around. They're all different kinds. They're good ones, they're bad ones. They can be angels or demons, okay? But what happens here is she sees the woman and the girl die, but in that courtyard after she's walked through those steps inside the church or inside the kingdom in this case, she sees the little girl climbing the evergreen tree. Evergreen trees represent life. Things that can endure through even they stay green even in the winter, right? So she sees them climbing, the little girl climbing. That means the effort she gave that she saw no results to did have an eternal value, okay? So we often don't see things the same way God does. Our perspective is not something we should trust. We trust God's perspective. And guess what? He doesn't always tell us what he sees. Sometimes we just have to trust and wait on the fulfillment of what he's done. Amen? All right, I'm going to go to this side because I did three from over here. So I've got one right here, and then I'm going to do the little one right there. Batgirl there, okay? We'll be next. All right, come on, Madeline.
All right, I've had two dreams in two weeks, and it's so hard.
I've had two short dreams in 2 weeks, and it's so hard to tell which one to say.
All right, pick one and let's go.
Okay. I was somehow found out I was pregnant.
Okay.
And then I saw this blue, just it was all blue, kind of a between an aqua and a royal, just a beautiful blue. And they were either embryos or they were seahorses, baby seahorses.
One of the two. That's good.
I couldn't tell. All spread out in there. That's it.
Okay. You knew you were pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And you saw this beautiful blue area with either embryos or seahorses spread out through it.
Little tiny ones.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Good dream. That dream says to you that you're about to bring forth some new things in the realm of revelation and prophetic gifting that you haven't seen before. So it's really simple dream, but it's an encouragement to you. It says you're about to bring life to something, or there's a new purpose or new ministry, a new a part of your walk that's about to be revealed. And it has to do with the realm of revelation. And there's a lot of new things coming around you too, not just what he's given you. Blue is a color of revelation. Pregnancy and having a child speaks of something we birth or we bring forth. Okay, that can be a ministry or a purpose in your life. And then the seahorses or the embryos speak of sea. It doesn't matter which they are. They both live in a water environment. okay? Either in the womb or in the ocean. So whichever they are, there's a lot of seed out there that's ready to be released in the earth, but God has put something in you for this time and this season. Good. Amen. Bless you. All right. A little bit right there. Tell me your name. Madison, come on up here. All right, Madison.
I was in like the desert and back when Jesus was alive, and there was a river behind me and people were lined up in front of me waiting for me to like heal them from different countries, and that's all.
That's all. That's pretty good. You know that short dreams can sometimes be the best dreams? Let me just say something to you here. Let's see how to say this. Let's interpret it first, okay? That dream says you have a call to healing. God has anointed you, even from your childhood, to release healing in the earth. Okay? You know what that means? Kind of. Well, you get with mom and pastor and some people, and you begin to learn about how God heals. Okay? Because you're a carrier of His healing anointing, and you want to be able to release it to people who come near you. And you don't wait to grow up. Okay? You start now. Okay? And you begin to pray and release that healing. Okay? Fair enough? It's a good dream. I like it. It's not really a dream, but we can interpret things that aren't dreams sometimes too. All right? Thank you. Now, Madison, you may not fully understand where I'm going to go here, but let me go ahead and go for mom's sake and for the rest of you. That's not a dream. That's a supernatural experience. That's an encounter. How do I know that? I don't know. I just heard the Lord say that's what it was when she started saying it. That was an impartation of anointing. Oh, let's see. Do we have time to explain this? God, our Father, is timeless. He exists outside of time. We exist in time. He can at any time He chooses take us out of time and put us back into a point in time of His choice. You notice she specifically knew she was walking at the time of Jesus by a river and a line of people. That is an encounter or an experience where the Lord removed her from time and set her in place. There are probably people who receive their healing from her obedience. Because even in a dream or an experience, you don't have to obey. You don't have to do what you're supposed to do. And you don't have to know all of what you did. Because the Word of God says that there are times when God seals our dreams. He seals them to keep us from pride. And even as a little one, if we knew all He may have done through that experience, it could cause pride later in life. So He seals up part of that dream and part of that experience and doesn't give the full picture, doesn't know the whole thing that occurred, simply because He's protecting and preserving innocence and humility. Okay? But that's two things. Not only does the dream say or the experience say there's a healing anointing, but it also says there's a seer anointing. And I suspect she already has significant dreams and visions and probably sees angelic and things of that nature. Do you know? Yeah. So a lot of those things, just be an encourager. With our children, we often want to say that was your imagination. And as long as you're holy imagination and you believe it's real, then okay. But please quit telling your kids it's just your imagination. We crush their supernatural spiritual experiences when we tell them it's just your imagination. That monster under the bed or that big man who helped on the playground may not have been an imagination. It may have been a demon. It may have been an angel. And it doesn't matter whether they're seeing the positive or the negative. If we crush it, they won't see it all. And so we need to help them overcome the enemy and cooperate with the heavenly. And so that's really important that we begin to teach and train our children differently from the way we were trained. We were taught it was our imagination for the most part. Looking around the age of us in this room, most of us were taught things were our imagination. Children are much more spiritual, much more supernatural, and their ability to enter into the things of the kingdom than we give them credit for. And so just be careful with it. Can the enemy throw a wrench in things when they have that gift and we don't understand it? Yes. But can the Lord bring real life out of it? Absolutely. So we just pray for Madison right now that you would protect and preserve that gift and call, that supernatural anointing. Father, we ask that you would oversee her and overshadow her, that she would walk in her fullness of purpose and destiny and fulfill all that she's called to, not being discouraged, but always being ready to move forward into that to which she's been equipped and prepared. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, we're going to stop here because we probably only have time for a couple more dreams. But here's what we're going to do. If you're here tonight and you've been through my dream classes, not just been to the workshops we've done, but been to one of the three-day classes on dreams, who's been to those? I know I've got a few right here, got right here, got one over there. I'm going to put you on the spot. If you don't step out and try, you never accomplish anything, but I will protect you, okay? Raise your hands again. You see these? There's Miss Candy here. We've got the two here. They've been to the dream class, okay? If you see those, don't wear them out. Two dreams. I got some in the back right there and Lisa back there. You see the ones there. So let's stand up. If you've been to the class, stand up for me so they can see who you are, okay? Got right in the back here, two here, coming down there on the steps, right here. You see these folks? If you didn't get a dream interpreter, you see these folks? Once they've interpreted two dreams, they're done. But that's 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18. That's about 18 or 20 more dreams that can be done, okay? But two is their limit. Now, here's the deal. Are you willing to let them try, even if they blow it and get it wrong? Is that okay? Okay, great place to learn, right? Okay, so we're going to let them step out and try, and you're going to make a safe place for them to learn. Guess what? You make a safe place for them, even if they get it wrong, God will somehow get you the right answer. Somewhere in there, He's going to take care of you, okay? So we're going to turn things over to them in just a minute. They're going to stand in the open area in the back for you, and you don't get the option of saying no, because you've been to my classes and you know what I'm like. So, if somebody will grab that basket for me, we're going to receive our offering. If you need an envelope, if you want to give by cash and you need an envelope, Lisa's got the envelopes there. Just wave at her and she'll give you one. If you want to give a check, you can make it out to Patria, P-A-T-R-I-A. There's a credit card form on the envelope. Don't give by credit. If you need to use a credit card to give, that's fine, but don't borrow money to give. Does that make sense? And I want to make sure you understand that. So if you need those things, I'm just sort of stalling, letting you prepare. Please do not feel obligation to give. If you see the value of what we're doing and the Lord has given you the ability to give, then we're going to do that and give that open door. If it comes by you and you're not ready, it's going to be on the table back there too. So just pass it around. I'm going to pray for it as you pass it, okay? And I'm also going to pray for you at the same time for an impartation of wisdom and understanding. So Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask you to bless this offering, that you would take what is given and multiply it to the work of your kingdom, but you would also take and return to those who give good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Father, we also impart to those who are here tonight that they would receive a new revelation of dreams and visions, and understanding would come to them. Would you stir up the gifts of the Spirit in their life? Would you stir up dreams and visions and strange events? And would you pour out your anointing? Whatever we have to give, we give away to them now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. See, amen. I'm a big believer. I don't think we all have to bow our heads and be real quiet when we pray. God hears us when everything's going on. So I don't have a problem that the offering basket's going around while we were praying. Just want to make sure you know that, okay? The cards are $5. Let me just say this to you. March 16th, the next Dream Lab. Also listen in on WDJC. I think I'm on at 6 a.m. this time. It's what they're saying. It's the early, early show. It's the 16th at 6 a.m. With Roxanne and Chris. And then we'll be back here that night for another Dream Lab. We'll also broadcast on Facebook Live that Dream Lab as well. So, yes.
They had a dream already interpreted.
Oh, yes. If you already had one interpreted, don't let give us 18 new ones for people who haven't had a chance to yet. And like I say, limit to two. You guys monitor that. Once you've done two, you're done, because you should be able to do two in 10 minutes, and that keeps you from being here and held up forever. All right, so there's the group in the back. They've got one for you. We release you. We bless you. If you need something from the book table, you can see me. And the basket's back there if it got by you during the offering. Thank you for joining us on Facebook Live. Thank you guys for joining us as well. And we will also post this Dream Lab on our Facebook, on our YouTube channel in the next couple of days. Blessings.